Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining the DrChrono webinar on the conversion to ICD-10. Welcome, and we're just going to get going. We're going to jump right into it. So what is ICD-10? And before we even talk about ICD-10, what is ICD? ICD actually stands for the International Classification of Diseases, and it was formed by the World Health Organization. The version, the ninth revision, known as ICD-9, was actually created in the 1970s, and today it's about 35 or 40 years old. And back in 1983, work actually began on ICD-10. Work was completed on ICD-10 in 1992. And in the US, a little known fact is that over 25 countries around the world have already converted successfully to ICD-10. A partial list includes Australia, which successfully converted in 99. Canada in 2000, China in 2002, France in 2005, Korea in 2008, South Africa in 2005, and the United Kingdom in 1995. So now, 23 years later, and after three delays, ICD-10 is set to go into effect on October 1st, 2015 in the United States. That is a short 126 days from today. It's about 4 months away. So that is the setting for our webinar today. A quick agenda. We have a special guest with us today, Dr. Ram. I'm going to provide an intro to him. He's going to give a little bit of a history and more of an overview on ICD-10. We're going to talk about the impact that this conversion has on everybody on this webinar, providers, staff members, all the stakeholders in the healthcare industry. We're going to talk about what your practice can do to get ready for ICD-10, what kind of mock claims you can send, and how you can practice coding notes with ICD-10. We're going to talk about specifically some of the changes that are going to be happening in DrChrono. On ICD-10, we have some screenshots and a demo on that. And then we're going to talk about some alternatives to managing this process on your own and what outsourcing this conversion to an expert such as DrChrono may look like. So Dr. Ram, who's our speaker today, has a deep background not only as a practicing physician, but also as an expert medical coder. He's been with DrChrono heading the compliance and medical coding division of our billing team for 3 years. And prior to that, he was a lead medical coder at a large hospital group. He has over 20 certifications from the AAPC. And without further ado, I am going to turn the presentation over to our speaker, Dr. Ram.
Thank you, Kyle. Hello, everybody. First of all, I would like to thank all of you for sparing your gracious time and to talk about the implementation of this ICD-10. It's a real privilege for me to address so many providers and healthcare professionals joining this webinar. I think let's go on to the first slide, which is the features and the benefits of ICD-10. So I feel here the transition to ICD-10 is a bit difficult for at least three reasons. Number one, the increase in the number of codes from 14,000 to 68,000, the increase in the length of characters from a maximum of 5 to 7, and thirdly, the mixing up of the alpha and the numeric characters. The code sets of ICD-9-CM have become too outdated and are no longer workable for treatment, reporting, and payment processes today. ICD-10 bridges this gap, and it is more flexible for growth, and the scope of expansion of the code sets is much higher. This is made possible by the use of placeholders denoted by the alpha character X in the ICD-10 CM. Another remarkable feature is a specificity of sites called laterality. If an ophthalmologist diagnoses a patient's condition as corneal ulcer, then there are four possible codes based on laterality as right-sided, left-sided, bilateral, and unspecified region. Though ICD-10 is considered a new coding term, it has significant merits. The first and foremost effect is that the new classification enhances the quality and efficacy of healthcare delivery. ICD-10 CM is a standardized diagnostic tool for epidemiology, health information management, and clinical purposes. It's highly effective for monitoring resource utilization, measuring performance, and analyzing healthcare costs and outcomes. Lastly, it helps in a bigger way to contain healthcare fraud and abuse and efficiently track public health and risks. Let's move on to the next slide, which is a digit structure. As you all can see, this is a basic anatomy of the ICD-10 code sets with 7 characters. There are also code sets less than 7 characters. The first 3 digits are referred to as a category, and the first character of the category is always an alpha. Digits 2 to 7 can be either alpha or numeric. Digits 4 to 7 describe the etiology, the anatomical site, severity, and complication of the medical condition. Let me explain the digit structure with an example in the next slide. Imagine a patient presents to an orthopedist office with an open fracture of right femoral shaft today. We would be reporting this as A21.11 per ICD-9 CM. But if the same patient presents on 1st October 2015, then this needs to be reported with S72.351C. Please note the substantial change in the ICD code description, which is displaced comminuted fracture of shaft of right femur, initial encounter for open fracture type 3A, 3B, 3C. Personally, being a coder, I have coded claims where the orthopedic surgeon simply document as femoral fracture, but now the orthopedist has to document the following if he treats a traumatic fracture. So documentation has to clearly state if it is a pathological or a traumatic fracture. So following is the elements that an orthopedic surgeon needs to document in his clinical note. Number one, it's a location and laterality. Number two, it's the encounter. Number three, is its open or closed fracture. Number four is a classification. Say for longer bones, he needs to document the Gustilo classification of fracture. And number five, it's a fracture pattern, terms like transverse, oblique, spiral, green stick, segmental needs to be documented. Number six is the alignment. This is just to tell you whether the fracture is displaced or non-displaced. And finally, it is a result. So the documentation of routine healing, delayed healing, malunion or non-union should be documented. So again, we just noted at the second point as encounter. So here, this is something which is a bit misleading. So it should be noted that the encounter in ICD-10 is not synonymous with the current procedural terminology coding, which is a CPT coding of a visit. So we, all of us, are aware that a visit in CPT coding implies the type of patient as new or follow-up. but an encounter in ICD-10 implies the treatment status, and it has nothing to do with the patient as new or follow-up. So the initial encounter codes are used when the patient is receiving active treatment. Subsequent encounter codes are used after the patient has completed the active treatment and when he's there in the recovery phase of the treatment. So it's no wonder that all variations of femoral fracture are reported with just 16 codes in ICD-9-CM, and this has multiplied to 1,530 codes in ICD-10-CM. So I think that the orthopedic surgeon will find tough times with the documentation. Let's move on to the impact that the ICD-10 has created. First, we can see for the providers, it must be honestly acknowledged that healthcare providers are at the receiving end because of the increased burden in terms of clinical documentation. Providers have to spend extra time writing elaborate notes in the form of interpreting the ICD-10 code specificity. This will significantly affect the face-to-face time that they need to spend with the patients clinically and will have to sit face-to-face with the clinical notes. I really feel very sometimes it is depressing being a physician on the other side. So it's a physician's workload increase with no expected increase in payment due to the increased requirements for providing specific information for coding and training the clinical and administrative staff to use a new code set may require significant hours, and the impact on the practice business process will be costly. On top of all these, there will be a disruption in the cash flow to a maximum of 50% during the initial stage of transition. So it will be a kind of tight corner if you're really not prepared. Let's see the impact that the ICD-10 has on the payers as well. The switch to ICD-10 will affect all major functional areas and interfaces. Even payers have to undergo rigorous internal testing of business processes. The local and national coverage determination policies need to be rewritten in order to accommodate the new code sets. Payers will have to reevaluate how they determine the medical necessity and start implementing new clinical treatment guidelines. After making system and process modification to accommodate 50-10 electronic transactions, payers will have to remediate, upgrade, or replace non-compliant claims adjudication systems and conduct a major underwriting initiative to develop new fee schedules. Let's see the impact that it creates on the medical coders and the medical billers. Though medical coders and medical billers are being categorized on the third stage, it is not the least level of, you know, the effect that they face. So when it comes to coding, the coding industry will undergo sweeping changes in terms of productivity, complexity, and clinical education. ICD-10 will be creating a huge shortage of productive coders because some coders may even plan to retire even before implementation. Coders will be struggling with insufficient documentation and keep requesting too many provider clarifications and queries. This will hamper both of the providers and the coders' productivity and can even sometimes lead to a strained physician-coder relationship. So I believe that if this is a perfect coding storm, this ICD-10 is a perfect coding storm that needs to be managed with rigorous training programs where the coder needs to be educated intensively on anatomy, pathophysiology, and even the surgical procedures. To sum up, the implementation of ICD-10 will pose a significant burden for providers and healthcare industry as a whole. So let's work together in dealing with this major transition. I think now Kyle will enlighten us on the ICD-10 preparedness for individual physicians and group practices. Thank you very much for listening to this webinar patiently. It's on to you, Kyle.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Dr. Ram. That was very insightful. So I'm just going to jump in to where Dr. Ram left off in terms of the impact that this conversion from ICD-9 to ICD-10 has on all of us. So a little bit of a checklist here for you guys to take an inventory of on your own practice. If you're using DrChrono, you're ahead of the game because the DrChrono team has spent the last several years, not only from a staff side, but also from a software side, preparing for October 1st, 2015. So if you're not using DrChrono, is your current EHR ready for ICD-10 and the conversion? In terms of clinical documentation, what level of documentation are the providers in the practice, and is the practice currently held to? What level of standard is there? Has there been an audit, a voluntary audit, a self-provided audit from a billing company such as DrChrono to review the clinical documentation and make sure that it's up to the ICD-10 standard? Has any financial planning been put into consideration for a transitionary period? If there is a decrease or a slowdown in cash flow before it speeds back up, does the practice have sufficient cash on hand to weather that period of transition? What type of training or testing has the staff in the practice done, as well as the providers? That goes to the next point. ICD-9 and ICD-10 in tandem. One of the things that I want to show you when I get into a little bit of a demo is how DrChrono has actually developed some software to be able to code both in ICD-9 and then also in ICD-10. And this serves really two purposes. The ability to be able to practice what you're not so comfortable with, but have the backup of having the ICD-9 code already there and what that looks like. That's one. And then two, in a downside worst case scenario, if some of the payers don't make the October 1st deadline and they are not able to accept ICD-10, you need a system that can support submitting claims and providing documentation under both systems, which DrChrono has prepared, and we're going to show you. And then in the last point, in terms of making sure all of the contracts with your insurance payers are up to date and the fee schedule is current, what type of process is in the practice to do a check on that on an annualized basis? Does that mechanism exist? So in terms of impacts that ICD-10 has on DrChrono, the software that you may be using right now, these are the areas of the software application that our software development team has been focusing on, sometimes just on our own and other times with the partners that we work with. So a key one is our lab partners, where we have bidirectional lab integrations. Our labs are certified with ICD-10, and we already are testing ICD-10 with both Quest and LabCorp. The other one is our clearinghouse partners. DrChrono is fortunate to work with two of the top clearinghouses in the country, MDON, as well as TriZetto, which is formerly known as Gateway EDI. So if you're a DrChrono customer, you may be sending claims through one of these two clearinghouses. Both are leading edge companies that have ICD-10 conversion plans in place. And so if you're not using DrChrono, or if your clearinghouse is not MDON and TriZetto, which ones are they and what is their plan to deal with the ICD-10 conversion? And then some other places within the software application, within the EHR application, where ICD-10 is going to have an impact on how you use DrChrono, the appointment pop-up window, how diagnosis codes are entered into the clinical notes, and some of the automation and profiles that we have, like pick lists and profiles. We've also incorporated the ICD-10 coding into our CCDA files for transfer to, direct messaging and referral of patients to other providers. Does the EHR system support sending those codes not only to clearinghouses and labs and within the software, but if you want to send a referral to another patient as a structured data file, will the diagnosis codes and the problem history transfer to that provider in which the patient is being referred? So here are some screenshots of what the new ICD-10 layout looks like in DrChrono. This one is the appointment pop-up window, and you can see on the bottom left-hand corner of the screen, we have now an ICD-10 drop-down with all of the ICD-10 codes there. And you can actually search two ways, just like in DrChrono under ICD-9, you could search by specific code, or you can search by the description. And the search works very well. I've been testing it out on my internal account. The billing profiles are also impacted. I'm going to show you actually a live demo of what this looks like. The fee schedule and the pick list also all updated for ICD-10. And also labs and lab ordering and diagnosis coding for labs. And then also some of our reporting. It's important that on reports such as the product and procedure report, where we might be doing searches on diagnosis coding, that we're not only supporting ICD-9, but we're also supporting ICD-10. So I'm just going to exit out of the presentation here just for a moment, and I'm going to open up my DrChrono account, and we're just going to make a little sample, kind of do a little demo here. So I'm going to go to the schedule on DrChrono. And I'm going to make a new appointment, and I'll make the appointment for my patient, Alex Hugh, and we'll select Alex, just like DrChrono works right now. And we're going to go over to the billing tab just to show what one of the new additions look like. So currently in DrChrono, we have something called a billing profile. So perhaps this patient was scheduled for a colonoscopy. So we'll enter that billing profile in, and you can see here that we have the ICD-9 codes and the CPT codes for this particular billing profile under the old system, ICD-9. And now in DrChrono, we have an ICD version here. So we can select from this drop-down box to ICD-10. And if we scroll down now, we can see the addition of the ICD-10 codes as well as the same CPT code that was there before. Now you see the additional level of complexity. The same diagnosis now includes 10 or 7 codes under ICD-10 when it only included 1 under ICD-9. So just in terms of a little demo to show you how live software is actually already working on DrChrono, we wanted to share that exciting information with you in that demo. So just in terms of where we go from here as a healthcare organization and as providers, what is the path to readiness? How do we accomplish this? So on-site management is one option. And that was that checklist that we showed. Is your EHR ready? Has your staff had training? Is there a fund for the rainy day during the transition? Who are your partners in terms of labs and clearinghouse? That can all be managed on its own, and that's one option. And DrChrono as a software company and provider sets up very well for that. And then an additional option is the ability to outsource that to a billing company such as DrChrono that offers an end-to-end solution for revenue cycle management as well as managed billing services. So just a couple of items on what DrChrono's complete billing service offers. In addition to the revenue cycle management, DrChrono offers the complete billing suite of tools on our Apollo Plus plan. So if you're currently on a plan that's not Apollo or Apollo Plus, like you may be on our Prometheus plan or on the Hippocrates plan, the addition of Apollo Plus is going to enable all of the software tools that we showed you in terms of the new drop-down boxes that include ICD-10. And then when you add Apollo Plus, we add mechanisms such as getting your fee schedule up to date with all of your insurance payers, making sure that on an annual basis we revisit that. We'll take the existing fee schedule that you have and all the diagnosis codes under ICD-9 and convert that to billing profiles and to a fee schedule that's compliant for ICD-10. And then once you guys complete all of the clinical notes, we actually take the process from there. So all that's required on your part is a complete documentation. Our medical coding team will review the notes and select the appropriate billing profile under ICD-10 or individual ICD-10 code, and then submit the claim and complete all of the follow-up until you're paid. We deal with the insurance companies, so you don't have to, and you can focus on practicing medicine and helping with your patients. If this presentation has sparked your interest and you'd like to find out more information about how DrChrono can help your practice convert to ICD-10, please do not hesitate to call us. We have people standing by, manning the phones and watching the email. So send us a note and we're happy to set up an individual demo with some of your data and show you how we can help you get moving forward with ICD-10. Thank you so much for joining our presentation today.